Hello and welcome to my record room in sunny Los Angeles. Today, more gems from the Decca catalogue. You know, if I was forced to pick one label which was my favourite label, I think Decca would be it. And it's because it's the beauty of the recordings of themselves in the early days, done very simply with the so-called Decca tree, just three microphones and maybe one or two other microphones added into the orchestra. And also just the range of recordings, the range of artists. There's something really special about this catalogue, and I'm thrilled to offer you some real gems today. I'm going to begin with one of the star violinists in the Decca catalogue, in particular in the early Decca catalogue, and his recordings are highly prized amongst collectors. And that violinist is Ruggiero Ricci. He was born in America, a child prodigy. He was performing all over Europe and America in his teens, and his career lasted through many, many years. He died at a ripe old age. He was to the Decca catalogue, I guess, what Yuri Menuhin and David Oistrakh, Nathan Milstein were to the EMI catalogue, and what Jascha Heifetz was to the RCA catalogue. His playing is typified by a lovely, sweet singing style. Ricci recorded all the standard violin repertoire for Decca, all the great concertos, sonatas, and at a certain point he also specialized in recording the music for solo violin, including the fiendishly difficult works by Paganini. But I'm going to show you one of his classic concerto recordings, and that is his recording of the Mendelssohn and Bruch violin concertos. Here he's accompanied by the London Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Pierino Gamba. This was made in 1958. It is an undisputed classic of both the Decca catalogue and of the catalogue in general. Now, I have two copies of this. This is the original release from 1958. As you can see, it has this gorgeous artwork, which is very much of the period. One of the things that's so fun about collecting records, and older records in particular, is you just get this wonderful artwork, which is completely of the period. I mean, who is on earth is going to release a record or a CD with artwork like this today? And this is also a very early pressing, as you can see here from the record. It's an early Decca wideband. You can see that the Decca label itself is not in a box, it's in this special lettering, and the wide band refers to this band here, which is much wider than later releases. And then also, when I bought this, it had the original inner sleeve. When you get these original inner sleeves, again, they're real period pieces, and it's just so much fun to have these, so I always keep them. In fact, this was one of the first records I bought as a kid, but I got it in this later re-release on Decca's The World of the Great Classics. This was a fantastic way to buy these records, and it still is. If you don't want to spring the big bucks for that original version, seek out this, because these re-releases on Decca were really excellent. And here's a nice little period thing. You see this sticker here that says it's 1911. And underneath it says 99p, and it says 99 new pence. That's because England had just switched to decimal in 1970. And this record, I must have bought this very soon after that, and they needed to put a label on it to explain to people exactly what the cost of a record was in the new decimal currency. And these World of the Great Classics, there are so many fantastic Decca recordings reissued like this, and it's a very easy way to get them without spending too much money, and that's what the label looks like. You can also pick up this record and a lot of the other Ricci recordings on Eloquence Classics. This is a label out of Australia which is doing these superb reissues of the Decca, Philips, Deutsche Grammophon catalogs, beautifully remastered, highly recommended. Next up, another early Decca, this time of chamber music. Now, Decca recorded extensively with the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestras, one of the great orchestras in the world. And allied to that, they made a series of recordings with a small group of musicians from the orchestra who were known as the Vienna Philharmonic Quartet. Now, this included Willy Boskowski, who was the leader of the Vienna Philharmonic, and he became famous later on for his recordings on Decca of various Johann Strauss waltzes, etc. But I love these chamber music recordings of the Vienna Philharmonic Quartet. Now, why are these recordings so special? Well, it's because it's a style of string playing. They really were the last generation. Very vibrato heavy, use of portamento, which is where you sort of slide from a low note to a high note. It's a way of linking the notes. It's a very rich sound, and it's very distinctive and quite lovely. I mean, today, I guess many people would frown down on this because we're used to a more stringent style of string playing. But one of the reasons I love collecting old records is you get these completely different styles of playing and the different sounds of orchestras with different kinds of instruments. And it's a real period piece. This is a lovely record of two Mozart quartets. You can see that it's the, again, the wide band Decca. And again, I was able to get it with the original inner sleeve. You can find these records reissued on Decca Eloquence again. I particularly recommend this coupling of two Mozart string quartets. This is a record you will pay a lot of money to buy in an early edition. So if you can't afford it, I would explore those Eloquence reissues. Moving forward in time, we come to one of the artists most closely associated with Decca, both his own compositions and then his own recordings, and that was Benjamin Britten. Britten was a little hesitant to present himself as a conductor. He first went on record, recording his own works, for example, the classic recording of his great opera, Peter Grimes, The Turn of the Screw. But I'm featuring now one of his records as conductor, and he was a superb conductor, and this is one of his great recordings. And this is of Mozart's 40th Symphony, together with the Serenata Notturno. Now, one of the reasons this recording made such an impression when it came out in the late 60s, I think it was around 1968, was that he observed all the marked repeats in the score. Typically, that was not done at the time, and so this recording really made an impression, and I think it puts the symphony onto a much grander scale than people were used to. We were used to the idea of the grand scale of the Jupiter Symphony, number 41, but not so much this one. This is actually my favorite Mozart symphony, and this recording is glorious. The cover here features the Snape Maltings, which was converted by Britten into a concert hall, and he made many of his recordings here, and it's a glorious hall. I actually attended concerts there. It's all brick, wood-lined, sprung wood floor. It's the perfect environment to record in, and all of these recordings are real classics. Now, even though this is a later issue, I actually have this copy, which is still on the wideband label, as you can see here. This is still being mastered with Tube Electronics, and it sounds wonderful. It just has a sense of air, of warmth. It's not that the later versions mastered with transistors are lacking, they actually sound terrific. But these earlier pressings where the tubes are in the mastering chain, they do have just that extra bit of magic. This is one of a number of records where Britten was conducting other composers, and he gained in confidence. And I can just say any of these records are worth picking up. They're simply wonderful. So musical, the recording itself is so beautiful. You can't go wrong with any of the Britten records on Decca. Thank you. Next up, a conductor that I would say most music lovers are more familiar with his recordings on Deutsche Grammophon and also Sony, that is Claudio Abbado. But he made a whole series of recordings for Decca in the 60s and 70s, and these, together with his early Deutsche Grammophon recordings with the London Symphony Orchestra, I think are amongst the best in his entire canon of recordings. I'm picking out a real favorite of mine, and this is his recording from the late 60s of music by Hindemith, the Symphonic Metamorphoses on a theme of Weber, and Janacek, the Sinfonietta. These are just glorious orchestral showpiece, and this recording is brilliant. Now, I first got this in its later pressing with the narrow band and the Decca inside the little box, but I recently found this recording, this pressing. It's a wide band, as you can see, Decca in the old style on the label, and so I could compare the two, and absolutely there is a difference. On these earlier pressing, you can hear the tube electronics just giving the sound an extra sense of breath, of air around the instruments, and to me it's really worthwhile, if you love this record as I do, to seek out that earlier pressing. This is wonderful, showy, orchestral magic. If you don't know these pieces, they are still tonal, even though it's 20th century music, and it's very accessible with beautiful use of the orchestra, colorful orchestration, lots of percussion, brass. The Janacek starts with this fantastic sort of brass fanfare, and it sounds glorious in this recording. There's a vivacity, a liveliness to Abbado's early London Symphony Orchestra, and the sonics on Decca are so superior to even the sonics on Deutsche Grammophon, unless you are able to pick up some of the SACD remasterings. But if you want to explore Abbado's earlier recordings, this is a great place to start. A wonderful record. I think it was also, may have been reissued by Speaker's Corner, and so you could seek out that version as well. Thank you. Now to one of the mainstay performers in the Decca catalogue. I mean, this is who they went to for all their great recordings of Debussy, Ravel, Russian music, and that was Ernest Ansermet conducting the L'Orchestre de la Suisse Romande. Every single video I do, I could pick out an Ansermet record or two or three, and they're all magical and special. For this video, I've picked out Ravel's opera, L'Enfant et les Sortilèges. This is a really delightful short opera. The story is basically of a naughty child who, in a tantrum rage, is ripping up all his toys, torturing them, and then the mother reprimands him and gives him a good talking to and sends him to bed. And what happens is all the destroyed toys start to come to life. And they kind of get their own back on the child, and he learns the lesson of that you need to behave and not destroy your toys. There are so many wonderful moments in this. A particular favorite of mine is when the cats are serenading each other. What else comes to life? I mean, the china cup, the fire comes to life, terrifying the child, a little old man, the green frog, the grandfather clock. This is an absolutely enchanting work. Even if you're not particularly an opera lover, I think you'll love this. It's got all Ravel's characteristic touches of beautiful orchestration and effects. Now, this copy that I've got right here is the copy that I originally bought. This is on the Ace of Diamonds label, which was one of Decca's main reissue labels. You can see here. What was fantastic about these is these were actually pressed at the same time as the original pressings. And so they sound identical to original pressings, but cost a fraction of the money if you want to pick them up that way. I also have this lovely Speaker's Corner reissue. Look at this, with the original artwork. Absolutely lovely, and they're meticulous. They do their mastering completely all analog. And from tape, from the original master tracks. And look, they keep the original inner sleeve. And there you have a copy of the original wideband label. Beautifully done. I can't recommend Speaker's Corner reissues highly enough. I think they're absolutely glorious. This is an opera which is so enchanting and delightful. And there have been some great recordings of this since. But this is still very, very special. Look at that, there's a complete beautiful reproduction. The vinyl itself is 180 gram. It sounds lovely. I love this kind of period stuff, telling you how to look after your stylus. Anyway, Ravel, L'Enfant et les Sortilèges, gorgeous piece, gorgeous recording. Can't recommend it highly enough. I'm going to finish with two sonic blockbusters, audiophile classics, which are also superb musically. Beginning with Prokofiev's first and second piano concerto. Now, I got this record because my music history teacher talked to us about the second piano concerto of Prokofiev, and the moment I heard it, I had to go and get it. It's an enormous concerto, fiendishly difficult. In the first movement, there is a cadenza, that's the passage in concertos for the solo instrument alone. This cadenza is so difficult. Well, in this recording with Vladimir Ashkenazi and Andre Previn and the London Symphony Orchestra, it's a take no prisoners version. Ashkenazi plays the bejesus out of this thing. It's incredible. And when the orchestra comes crashing in again with a big tune at the end of the cadenza, at the end of the first movement, it's absolutely riveting.
Thank you.
This is a classic Decca recording with many of the great engineers involved, including the great Kenneth Wilkinson. I have the complete box up here. If you like this music, you need to buy this complete box, even though it's never been reissued. If you can find clean copies of this, and wow, it sounds amazing. These are all extraordinary pieces, the absolute apex of tonal Russian 20th century music. Cannot recommend it highly enough. Also included a couple of other pieces, and even on this record we've got the overture on Hebrew themes, which is quite lovely. It's with Ashkenazi and clarinet, and played by Keith Puddy, and the Gabrielli string quartet. Wonderful record, getting either this or the complete box set. And in conclusion, another sonic blockbuster, Berlioz's Damnation of Faust. This recording came out in the early 80s and I got it immediately. Now, Decca was one of the first labels to embrace digital recording, and of all the labels, I think the early digital recordings by Decca are still pretty much the ones that are bearable on record. They sound pretty damn good. This recording really made waves, and I'm going to read you an extract from the original review in the Gramophone by the great critic Alan Blythe, because this is what I read, and then I just had to buy this thing. "Batten down the hatches," Blythe wrote. "Send your neighbors away on holiday, then take out this new version of Damnation to give your hi-fi an evening out. This is a recording of quite startling range and depth." Blythe wrote that until he had heard Schulte's discs, he would never have imagined that a recording of a work could give listeners such an overwhelming sense that they were experiencing Berlioz's music from a seat in the orchestra stalls. Now, in some ways, Blythe preferred Colin Davis' classic recording of Damnation, but he did say that the sheer impact, immediacy, and presence of Schulte's entertaining and uplifting version was such that some listeners would prefer it. I just love this recording. There's a famous orchestral showpiece in the work, the Hungarian March, and Schulte's version just blisters through it. You also have the wonderful Frederica von Stader on this. She is one of my favorite singers. I heard her in the opera house. She's glorious. Also Josef van Damme as the devil. Oh my God, he is just fantastic. This is one of the classic Decca recordings from Chicago. If you want to explore this work, it's an interesting piece. It's a sort of hybrid opera oratorio. It's been done on stage. There have been a couple of very good productions recently. There's one on DVD, which I have somewhere, which I would highly recommend. But for an audio-only recording, I think it's between this one and the classic Colin Davis. Also, Colin Davis's later recording on LSO Live is very good indeed. But there's real magic and fire to this. Schulte is in his element. So if you can find it, I would grab it and give it a listen. Okay, that's it for today. I'll be back with more gems from the various catalogues. Definitely some more gems from the Decca catalogue. But in the meantime, thank you so much for watching. Always happy to read your comments. Give me some likes if you want. Please subscribe if you are watching these on a regular basis. So until the next time, happy listening.